Welcome back, everybody, to our second match of the day. It is going to be Sneaky Nick's Assassins. They just faced up against Na'Vi US and ended up losing in the Winner's Bracket Finals. That means they will now be dropping into the Loser's Bracket Finals to face up against Dream Destroyers, a team that was knocked down by Na'Vi US as well in the very first round and managed to make their way all the way through to get here to lose bracket finals. So we'll see whether or not they have what it takes to take on a team like SNA, because they are certainly going to be the underdogs in this matchup, but they have yet to face them. So I have no idea if these two teams have faced each other in the past or whether this is completely untested ground for Dream Destroyers. We'll see how it goes as I welcome in my co-caster, Mr. Nahaz, the Stats Man, is going to be joining me once again.
Yeah, just unbelievable, Cap, that Dream Destroyers have made it this far. So just for reference, their drafter, Bloody Nine, in this match, he only has, I think, two Pro Dota wins outside of this tournament. And those are both in SIVO last season. It is just a huge upset that they are here. And frankly, looking at their matches, it's been their drafting. Their drafting has worked extraordinarily well, enabled them to rattle off back-to-back wins over Not Today and Union Gaming yesterday, both of whom would have been heavily favored in those matches. And they're starting off this game with pretty much the same draft that they used against Union Gaming, with Justin on the Razor, who went 11-3 in a 37-minute win in that game, and they also had a Nature's Prophet. Bloody Nine has been running the Nature's Prophet wins in their last three matches, and he has been running that Null Talisman and Blade Mail build. And by the way, for those of you who do not recognize Justin, Justin's formerly of EHUG, had 35 kills in two games as TA in the TI4 Americas qualifier, nearly brought back EHUG in the qualifier despite a just disastrous first day. So he is an explosive playmaking player, and I think they might be able to challenge SNA in this series.
Yeah, he certainly, I actually, if those of you guys who have been following the MSI Beat It with me, I have actually talked about Justin a number of times when he went into games with Dream Destroyers, and I did talk about his play on EHUG, and I actually had a long conversation with Pandago about his team going into the TI4 qualifiers and exactly what he wanted to see from his team, what would be happening afterwards, et cetera, et cetera. And he went ahead and let me know that I wasn't really expecting much of Justin, to be honest. Like, when I'd seen many of EHUG, Justin was by far the one player that I knew nothing about. Every other player I recognized from my time in the U.S., and I recognized them as either up-and-comers are already established players, like Pandago himself, who is a very good player. Rio Burrows, when he was on that team, already kind of an established player in the North American scene. Justin, not so much. Justin was more of them looking for a replacement, them needing a fifth, and them needing a dedicated fifth, and finally stumbling upon this guy. And I wasn't really sure. I really thought that, like, seeing from the games that I had seen of his, I wasn't entirely impressed by his play. And I, until I talked to Pandago, and Pandago said if I had to remake the team, Justin would be one of the players I would keep 100%, because that guy has a lot of potential. He is going to be a great player in the future because of the fact that he is able to learn from his mistakes. While he's a bit more on the amateur side, I mean, may not have as much skill as some of the other players that Dire they were playing with at the time. He was a very rapid learner, and we could see that he definitely didn't impress me before, but once he went into the TI4 qualifiers, he made some damn big plays and basically made a name for himself off of some of those, you know, clutch plays he was able to pull as a carry or as a mid position. So I'm looking forward to seeing him here. I haven't really seen too much from him so far. The one player that has really stood out for me on the Dream Destroyer side, and it was basically off of one game's performance on the Pugna, which they're going to pick up for him again, but that's Chobo, another name I have no idea who it was, but he had some very impressive plays on the Pugna, and he is, for me right now, the standout player for Dream Destroyers, not Justin.
Well, at least a couple of the people in our chat have suggested, I think they might have been talking about Squee, they're standing here, but a couple of players have suggested that those guys, one or both of those guys, might come from Han. So that may be why we're not familiar with them. But we do have some interesting drafts coming out here. This is so very, very smart, in my opinion, by Sneaking Assassins to ban out the Tinker. So no Hepatitis T in this match. they used that combination very, very effectively to win the rat race against Union Gaming last night. We're not going to have that, but we're going to have a very, very strong pushing lineup with the Jakiro and the Pugna. We are going to get to see Way Too Sexy on his signature Shadow Shaman. I think a couple of days ago might have gotten a little overexcited and called him the best Shadow Shaman in the world. That's probably not true. There are a handful of players on Shadow Shaman on the Eastern scene that are just unbelievable on that hero. I think he is the best Western Shadow Shaman player, and I think we'll get to see that in this match. The Alchemist and Juggernaut, though, just when you think with the first three heroes in the draft that Sneaky Nick's Assassin are going standard meta, you have the Alchemist and the Juggernaut coming out. And just looking at it right now, I'm not sure how they're going to lane this.
It's definitely odd. That's for sure. I mean, it looks like it's definitely going to be an aggro try of some sort. And we're going to be seeing, I guess, Brewmaster and Alchemist as cores, though there's a possibility that they run the Alchemist as a support and put the Skywrath Mage as a core position. That is the other possibility, but it should, no matter what, be an aggro try, in my opinion. Just because I am not that big of a fan of any of their cores that they have right now. Being an offlane, the one that would be most likely would be the Brewmaster, but I much prefer, I think he really needs that early start that the Earthshaker gives him with a Fissure Block. I think that's kind of necessary for a Brewmaster offlane to truly be successful, especially against Dream Destroyers, what is very obviously a very strong tri lane, and is going to be made even stronger with the Nature's Prophet added in as the offlane that is going to be able to teleport in and give them a fourth player on the field.
Okay, so it does look like they're definitely going to run that aggressive tri lane with Way Too Sexy, Shadow Shaman, and Fluff and Tough Skywrath Mage. Mm-hmm. Probably around the Juggernaut, I would guess, sending IX Mike solo up into that top lane against Bloody Nine's Nature's Prophet. Now, it's a good kind of a combination where when you see a push lineup on the Radiant side like this, Pugna is usually going to be running a defensive tri line anyway. And one of the really good things, of course, you do as Dire is you try to put pressure on that by drafting a very strong aggressive tri line. I think Wraith King was a very nice last pick in terms of trying to shore up that defensive tri line down there. Pugna and Jakiro, not necessarily the best. Both of those would have been pretty easy kills for that aggressive tri line if they try to go that route. I think Wraith King was a very nice last pick to try and shore some of that up.
Yeah, I'm sure he was banned at some point in time, but I honestly would have preferred a different melee, and I would have loved to see the Earthshaker for the defensive tri lane. Wraith King still gives me some concerns because he can still be a squishy hero, just because he is a frontline hero, but he also doesn't necessarily have the greatest stats in the world. I would have kind of rather seen a good zoning hero like the Earthshaker that would also be able to give you the stronger initiation. Which is something they're kind of lacking right now. They do have this really good push squad, but they don't really have initiation. I mean, if the Wraith King gets a Blink Dagger, they'll get some. But even that is kind of questionable at how strong a single target missile stun is going to be as an initiating force for you.
Well, that's kind of the thing, right? That as when you draft this strong of a pushing lineup, you don't necessarily have to have that kind of initiation. Don't get me wrong. You always, this is at this level of Dota, you always want to have solid initiation. But when you have a pushing lineup like this, if you have a strong enough laning phase, they have to come to you. You can get away without necessarily having one of your strong traditional teamfight initiators. And of course, anytime you're on the Radiant side and you have the potential where if that lane goes well, that the Wraith King is going to be able to farm up uncontested in that Radiant side jungle. You know, we talked about this in the last match, that he's that kind of hero that can just beautifully make that transition into the mid game as a four position core.
Uproot and after them.
All right, the pause is no longer.
We may have been wrong. It may be IX Mike solo offlane on the Alchemist, and we may have the tri-lane top. What's going on here?
Aggro try, always risky. But
on the Radiant side, I don't think you.
I don't know about IX
this
Mike.
This is just early ward rotation. I mean, I. And look, hey, you know what? far be it for me to second guess Mike. Mike was the one that brought us the sole offlane Faceless Void. So I guess I can't. Well, I mean, obviously there are other players that deserve credit for that as well. Yeah,
clearly, Bulba invented it. All right.
So, Bulba invented everything. Of course, we know this.
Bulba invented IX Mike. So even if IX Mike invented it, Bulba is truly the source of it. So.
I bow to your superior wisdom, snip. But anyway, yeah, this is interesting. If these two supports from DD stay top, I will be a little bit surprised here. Razor is surprisingly good in a trial-in situation, but boy.
The battle begins.
Yeah, it's going to be tough no matter what happens here. So the aggro try coming out from Dream Destroyers, they're going to be running with a Razor, Wraith King, as well as the Jakiro, which makes them a very, very potent tri lane up against a bit more defensive tri lane, I would say. You've got two very squishy supports on the side of Sneaky Nick's Assassins, plus a melee core. That's going to be a pretty rough position for them to be in overall. The mid matchup is going to be our Pugna, Chobo's Pugna, facing up against TC in the mid lane of the Brewmaster, and then we have a 1v1 matchup, Nature's Prophet versus the Alchemist. And that makes, if they didn't know it was going to be an aggro try, it makes a lot more sense that the Alchemist is going to be our offlaner here, as he's perfectly viable. And I'm not sure why Bloody Nine, he's really scared of some early support rotations right now. He's playing this very passively, but the result is actually going to be the Skywrath Mage making his
Pugna's
way
in trouble,
behind the Pugna. Leading with a slow, TC is going to be able to follow up with the clap, and poor Pugna cannot possibly stand under that kind of early nuking power.
And this is why I don't understand the way they lane this, because Razor is just so much harder to rotate. I mean, he of course you can do it, but he is so much harder to rotate on earlier than that Pugna is in the mid lane. He's just incredibly vulnerable. And to me, any time as the Radiant side, that the Dire side wants to give me a free tri lane, a free safe lane tri lane against a solo offlaner with not much impact, like an Alchemist in the early game anyway, I'll take it, man. I'll farm my Wraith King up inside that jungle all day. So yeah, I don't know about the laning decisions here, but you know they have drafted and laned well to get this far in the tournament. So I'm going to give them a little credit here and see how this turns out.
Yeah, we're going to see already Static Link going down on Degenerate. He's going to be forced to use his spin as a stun came out from Freedom, but wasn't quite enough. Bottom lane, they're going to go for a dive, but the teleport away is going to be able to get the Furion out. And I'm almost wondering if Furion, he does have a teleport up. I was almost wondering if he was going to try and teleport back in, as IX Mike did stun himself underneath the tower, but he didn't end up going for it. Too risky up against the Skywrath Mage. He will eventually come back. This time around, though, he will not have a teleport, so he needs to be careful about that dive. But I do like the fact that Sneaky Nyx Assassins, and this has become apparent between the Tier 1 and Tier 2 teams and some of the amateur teams, is that teams that have a losing laning phase will not just try and stay there and deal with it, but they'll rotate their supports around and try and get an advantage by ganking up the other solos.
Right. Now, I mean, that's that in this current metagame, that's just absolutely crucial. And I think we might have Pugna going down mid here again.
He's going to poke his way straight up. He knows, thanks to that ward. Freedom's actually going to come in and doesn't have enough mana. Damn. Could have been a quick, easy kill on the Shadow Shaman.
Now, but that was why you saw, you commented on it very early, that's why you saw Bloody Nine playing so defensively. I'm a little bit surprised. Okay, he is going to send his Treants out here into the jungle to scout for these ganks. He should be able to keep himself relatively safe, barring mass smokes.
Uh-oh. No, he overextended himself. He wasn't paying good enough. I mean, he probably saw him, but he just overextended himself slightly, and he now will be dying. As Ike's Mike's initiation should be enough. Bloody Nine has nowhere to hide. He's actually going to try blocking Mike. Oh, he's going to get him. Mike, he can't possibly get out of here. A cool little hole, but Bloody Nine still manages to get it. One for one trade, and Freedom's actually going to be rotating to the bottom lane, where with the Furion up, I was thinking they may try and go on the Skywrath Mage, just because the Skywrath Mage starts out with no armor. So if they can manage to surprise him with a teleport behind an early sprout before the Alchemist is here, they could absolutely be able to kill him real quick, but that's not going to be the case. The Alchemist is already back in lane, and it's going to be a dual lane now as the Razor and Jakiro will continue to try and shut down this Juggernaut, who is not getting much CS, but he is getting full levels.
Little strange decision there by IX Mike in trying to get around those trees. He had actually gotten outside of tower range, so he was blocked in, but he wasn't in tower range, and he actually stepped back in tower range in an effort to get out of that treant surround. I'm not sure. He might have been able to live there, but That's all right. As a result of that, Bloody Nine at least gets something out of that, and he's doing decently well here, so on this bottom lane.
Justin, once again, forcing Degenerate back. He's going to actually be forced to use a health potion as the constant harassment of the Jakiro has been keeping him low. Looks like they're now going to try and go for a kill onto Squee here. Justin doesn't have that static link, and that's why they're able to be so aggressive. Squee will still be falling here, but it's going to be a trade-off. It's way too sexy. Has no chance to be able to live through that plasma field, and Degenerate will be chased away once again. So in the end, it was the only chance for them to get aggressive on the side of SNA, and yet it still results in a kill going back to the side of Dream Destroyers.
Yeah, and with that, we are seeing a little bit of how they chose to at least start the lanes off this way, that Razor is just having a field day up here. It's almost free farm for him.
And Plenty Nine has still been able to make this 1v1, not really 1v1,
right,
seeing as the Skyrath Mage has rotated around so much, but he's still been able to make it work for him, being able to get a decent amount of levels and some good CS. I mean, 20 and 8, considering the large amount of harassment he's been facing, he's only slightly behind the Brewmaster.
I mean, look at how scared they're going to get going on here behind the Tier 2 tower top, and Way 2's dead.
Yeah, they're going to try and get a trade kill as Justin is getting low, but he's already started stealing some damage away. Degenerate, he's really wanted to be able to go for this kill. Justin will be falling, though. Maybe they can get something in return, though. Ice Path's going to be able to land on Fluff.
Wow.
We also have Degenerate, who's very low. They're going to continue to go down. Squeeze kind of drafted himself in a corner, misses the dual breath, and Fluff and stuff is running out of mana now. That last little hit, Omni Slash goes down. We'll be able to get that one kill. Bloody Nine needs to turn and try and get a kill on Degenerate. Lands the Sprout, and that will ensure the kill, as there's no way to be able to eat through those trees. Freedom also may try and sneak into Fluff and stuff, but is outside of range, and with the boots and high amount of natural movement speed on its Skywrath Mage, there's no way he can catch him.
Just a crazy amount of early game trades going on here, but behind all these trades is the fact that DD really is getting the CS advantage. I mean, Brewmaster leads the board with 37 last hits, but then the next three on the board are all on the Radiant side. And you're going to see here that this action's not going to stop anytime soon as Sneaky Nyxus has to smoke up and head bottom trying to get a kill on the Razor here.
Yeah, Justin realized as soon as Ike's Mike popped that unstable concoction, he's like, oh dear, this is a mistake. Way too sexy. Oh, he needs one more hit, but he couldn't quite get it. Nice attempt at a turnaround there from Justin, but wasn't quite enough as the Brewmaster joins the ranks of the Shadow Shaman when it comes to ganking. Now, Chobo's getting a bit low from taking a lot of aggro from this tower. A little silly for him to be dropping so low, but they're trying to take down this Tier 1 tower early in exchange for that attempt to get ganked. Meanwhile, Freedom is going to try and farm up his level 6, but he does have to be careful up against the Juggernaut, whose spin is not quite deadly, but if he gets a little bit too much harassment on the Wraith King, or even just one rotation, that can easily turn into a quick kill on the Wraith King before he has reincarnation.
So do you agree with their decision here? I think I feel like they tried to DD, that is, tried to transition out of the laning phase into that early push just a little bit too quickly. They were doing fine on the lanes, and you saw them TP the Razor down bot, switching up after the top lane had gone so well for them, and transition into that very, very early push mid. I feel like they've given back a little bit of that advantage that they got early.
Yeah, I believe the reason that they didn't have teleports for the bottom lane when Justin was gone on, he got a lot of damage on everybody who was coming in. Like, the Alchemist had no health. Way Too Sexy, obviously, was left with just one hit as well. The reason I don't think we saw any rotations from anybody
Freedom
there
needs to be careful here
is because the fact they didn't have those teleports in. They didn't have the Furion teleport because they already went to the mid lane, and everybody else had already gone middle as well, so they didn't have the TP scrolls. I agree with you. I think they should have just sat back in the laning phase and waited a little bit longer.
No, I mean, it's always a question, right, when you've got an extreme push lineup like this, you know, when do you make that transition? But I feel like going that early is something that you do when maybe the lanes aren't going ideally for you. I mean, they had an advantage here. This Juggernaut was getting nothing done, and then all of a sudden, he's now back in the game, right? I mean, he's level 8 and has been able to get some of that early CS deficit back.
Yeah, and there really hasn't been much coming out from Dream Destroyers. They try to push in the middle lane, got it pretty low, and they'll take it eventually. But for now, they're actually going to be being pushed on as the top lane is now going to push forward. Since Juggernaut has that Omni Slash, he's not really scared anymore of just solo heroes. Maybe if it was two or three, they wouldn't be as aggressive. They're going to be able to take the bottom Tier 1 tower, though, and should be able to rotate up to top.
Trouble in trouble mid here. Oh,
yeah. He's done for. Tornado goes off, interrupts. Oh, he's turning it around, gets a little bit of a blast, but eventually he will fall as there's too much magic damage. Meanwhile, top lane, Freedom does pick up his reincarnation, and Degenerate does not want to try and use his Omni Slash just for that ultimate. So they'll still take some good control, and that was a one-for-one trade when it comes to towers, but of course the Brewmaster did use his second ult of the game to be able to finish off the Pugnar.
Yeah, which is perfectly okay, though. I mean, when it gets you, you're against a pushing lineup like this, and you're the ones taking the tower advantage at this point after it looked like you might be losing the laning phase. I mean, it's not going to necessarily show in the golden XP graph, but the last couple of minutes have just been such a huge turnaround for Sneaky Nyx Assassins, in my opinion. You know, it looked to me briefly in this game like they might be the ones getting snowballed on, and now it's looking like they're the ones that might do the snowballing.
Yeah, things have kind of stalled out. They still need to be able to pick up their basic pushing items, I would say, at the very least. Like, be able to finish off. Well, okay, Chobo's actually going to be going for a Hood of Defiance himself. And I don't think that's the ideal item for a Pugnup, but the pipe is going to be necessary eventually, so I guess he has to get it. Way too sexy. He was trying to pick up his wards, and he's going to be caught because of it. He really wanted to get those Serpent Wards up, but unfortunately, still not level 6 and does get caught by the rotation, which is going to result in a small push, but they already got that Tier 1 tower.
Yeah, interesting to me that Bloody Nine was the one who rushed the mech in this game. He actually used that Null Talisman. He actually went the 3 Null Talisman Blademail build that we were talking about in the last game. And, TC getting another kill in mid lane. I'm worried that this is going to start to fall apart here for DD. I really am.
Yeah, I think so, too. They're having a harder time. Degenerate's going to be locked inside with a Sprout, but Justin doesn't choose to put the static link on him. Instead, just tries to lay a little bit of right-click damage on the Tier 1. Chobo almost overextends himself there, and they will be losing the ward. Meanwhile, the mid lane, Freedom will teleport in, make sure the Tier 1 tower push doesn't come into play. They really need to finish off these Tier 1s before getting greedy and going for Tier 2s, I think.
Yeah, I agree, and it's frustrating because, you know, this is the kind of pushing lineup where if you do have any kind of a lead, you might be able to take an early Tier 2, but boy, it is really frustrating having this kind of a draft to be trading towers this early, to feel like, okay, well, we're pressuring, but they're not forced to defend. I mean, that's the whole idea that we were talking about at the very beginning, is that you don't necessarily have to have that classic initiation as DD's draft here, because you're the ones doing the pressuring. They have to initiate into you. Now, though, they are going to be forced into situations in this game where they're going to have to mount a defense, and that's where that lack of initiation could potentially really, really hurt them, especially against the lineup composition they're faced with here.
5-8, 11.5 minutes in. We've got a 750 gold lead right now for SNA, and, a pretty large experience lead, almost bordering around the 4,000 mark. Mm. The early mech being picked up by the Nature's Prophet does give them a slight advantage for the time being, as SNA don't have a mech finished up themselves just yet. That's going to be on the Alchemist. I actually really love, this is the second time I've seen Ike's Mike run the offlane Alchemist. And I do like it when he goes for the mech, because I feel like the mech already makes you very, very tanky. On any hero, but the armor especially is very important for certain heroes. Alchemist is one of those heroes that starts out with very low armor, so that increase of armor is huge for him, but it also gives you a lot more sustain as an alchemist, where that change of chemical rage, which took away the boost of health that you get, you know, like a jump up in health, it's all about the regen now, which for some people was a nerf. I think in many ways, many ways, it was a nerf, but there are those slight situations where it actually becomes a buff, where if you look at it, the heal over time of the chemical rage outdoes the basic amount of regen that you used to have, plus the health increase that you used to have. So if you can survive long enough with that chemical rage, it actually gives you more HP as long as you were hurt in the beginning and are always regening that up. It actually can make you tankier than you were before. But that requires you're still susceptible to a lot of burst damage because you no longer have that boost of HP. Mech does give you that.
Yeah, what that change was just a massive nerf to the support Alchemist. I mean, I agree with you. I don't think it hurts core Alchemist much at all, really. Mm-hmm. But in terms of a support, if you're under leveled, as an alchemist now. You really are very squishy. And it's funny because you think about an alchemist and people think about playing against alchemists in pub games. He ends up being, because of the way he's built, one of the more tanky heroes. But what we were seeing after that change is that the few times I saw support alchemist run after the change, he just vanished in team fights. He got nuked down instantly. He was one of the squishier heroes in the game for the reason that you mentioned. But yeah, I mean, he's level 9 at this point. He's almost got that mech up and about 300 gold. He's doing fine, right? That ultimate now, the change to him doesn't hurt him really at all here.
Yeah, you know, what really is 50 extra health regen a second if you die in 2 seconds?
Yeah, pretty much.
It's an extra 100 health. That's really compared to the big jump that you used to get as a support alchemist in the past. It looks like Justin's going to be going for the drums into Aghanim's build. When you don't have to go for a mech, that is the typical build. BKB is a sort of situational item for Razors, but there, right. Other than that, there's pretty much only one build when you don't have to go for the mech. So I'm not sure if BKB is really necessary this game. It's hard to tell because there's a Skywrath Mage, of course, and that's dangerous. But at the same time, there's also that Omni Slash that's coming into play. I think this is still another one of those games where, despite the fact that Aghanim's does give you a lot of extra survivability and a big increase in damage, I would almost want to go for the BKB instead, just because of the fact that, well, it means your Razor just doesn't care about heroes anymore. There's not enough physical damage in the game to be able to really kill him during a 10-second BKB.
Well, to me, it depends on how quickly the Pugna can get the pipe up. If the Pugna can get a pipe up and you've got a mech and a pipe on your side and you've got this extreme push lineup anyway, then I go ahead and go for the Aghanim's. And I might not even finish the drum. Because if you're this Razor and your team can get that mech and pipe up for you and you can get that Ags by like 20 minutes, these towers are going to fall so quickly, right? But the big problem is that Pugna has such a hard time early in that mid lane. Chobo is really still quite a ways off. I guess he's only 70 gold or so from the Ring of Health to finish up his hood, and then about another 1K on top of that, or 1500 on top of that to go for the pipe. But yeah, he's still a ways off, so the Razor probably is going to hold on to his gold here for the next couple of minutes, if not just go ahead and finish the drums.
The problem with the problem I really see with the pipe pickup here on the Pugna is that while armor and magic armor are definitely a huge part of the game, they oftentimes aren't that important early on, because basically what it comes down to, you look at the Pugna, he's got 600 health. If you're increasing the amount of magic defense you have against a lot of these nukes, it does help. It does increase your survivability quite significantly, and yet you are still glass cannon. If you have a lot of HP, obviously, a Hood of Defiance is that much more effective on you. If you have a very, very small HP pool, it doesn't really make that much of a big difference, because you can still be overwhelmed by just one extra nuke. You know.
Oh no! This is all about the pipe here, though. Is all about the team.
True. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Pugna is betting on his position and being good anyway. He's one of those heroes, you know, not quite as extreme as Sniper, as we've joked about in the past, that if you get out of position, you're dead regardless of your build. But Pugna is very much along that direction, that his positioning needs to be good anyway. And as you said yourself, there is not that much physical damage in this game until later when Alchemist comes online. The Juggernaut's Omni Slash is fine. But again, if Pugna is positioned properly, he shouldn't necessarily be that vulnerable. I will go ahead and give a shout out to Healy. He just messaged me and said, tell people that Squee is the best. So I don't know the player, but hey, if Helium likes him, he can't be all bad. And there, I said a nice thing about Helium. I'm a good person. That's like my good deed for the month.
Yeah. No, I mean, I do totally get the reason he's going to go for the pipe. The problem for me is that the investment of gold up until you finish the pipe is not really worth it,
yes,
right?
Because that's absolutely right.
Until you finish the pipe, you're still really squishy. You don't even have that barrier, which at least makes you very tanky. You don't have that extra presence in the team fights necessarily. So it's a pretty big gold investment and that isn't really going to pay off, I see, until probably about 20 minutes. I really don't think he's going to realistically finish the pipe before then. That's my problem with it, but I do understand the general consensus. Mech and pipe, and you're going to have all this team fight. It's going to be amazing. And it's really going to pay off once they finish the pipe, and it's going to pay off even more once he can start getting some stat items, such as a point booster and an ogre club building into that inevitable Aghanim's. And that'll be very big for him. I'm just not sure if he's going to make it at this rate. We'll see. Sneaky Nyx Assassins are getting some of their basic items. As we said before, the mech is almost up on the Alchemist. We have the Blink Dagger up on TC and Degenerate. Well, how much gold has he got? He's got 1,000 gold left. And has both Ring of Akilla and, well, as a phase boots. But really the biggest thing for him, what do you think his build is going to be this game? Do you think this is an Aghanim's build?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's Drums Axe all the way. I mean, yeah. I still think that just because of the mana limitations, as well as the fact that Juggernaut himself is actually not the tankiest hero in a lot of circumstances, I would like to see him finish building the drums first. But I've seen straight Ags on Juggernaut. It's not terrible, right? You get the point booster first. It can work. But no, I think this is a drums Ags game all the way. I think that Aghanim Scepter on Juggernaut, just especially with the amount of other team fight damage and control that they've got, I think that Aghanim Scepter on Juggernaut could just be awesome. Well, it was recently buffed. I mean, they need physical damage from somewhere, and physical damage doesn't always have to come from right clicks. That's the thing. That's true. The fact that Alchemist Unstable Concoction is physical is actually potentially very significant in this game. As you said, Pugna, if he eats that Alk stun to the face, Pugna is going to be in a world of hurt.
Yeah, that's where those clutch decrepify timings are going to come into play.
Yep.
I do want to mention I have seen Squee before. And I actually saw him in my pubs a couple of times. And I think, if I recall, he did do pretty well. So, but other than that, I've only seen him in so far in the MSI beat it.
Well, since we've got some time, I mean, I spent some time at one point when I did baseball statistics as a hobby, thinking a lot about how minor league stats translated into major league stats, and it's a kind of a hard problem. One of the things that I wonder all the time about Dota is that, I mean, how do you look at a guy in a pub match and try and forecast how he's going to do at this level? Because to me, I mean, I see a lot of guys in pubs that look really, really good, and it's like they get on a pro team and just kind of don't do anything.
Honestly, sorry, just getting reading through the chat real quick.
Yeah.
So the game is just completely different. I would say I don't think that minor league and major league. At least there's some correlation between, like, the game is still the same. It's just at a higher skill level, right? Would be a basic way to be able to say it. But when it comes down to pub play and competitive play, I think there are enough significant differences that you can't actually. You can't actually compare the two, because I can tell you that players that I've played with on teams, and even going into, like, some players that I still know, like, because when I was playing competitively, we didn't have matchmaking yet. But even I was still playing a little bit once we got matchmaking. But even now I know some of the players and I know some of their ratings, and I can tell you that their ratings don't necessarily reflect. But that's the thing, is they do really well in pubs, right? And like, I would queue with these guys, and yet when it comes down to the actual playing competitively, and the reason and this actually reminded me, because I was playing some officials today, and I was playing with a really good friend of mine who is really good. Like, he's a good pub star. He plays in NEL and he plays all these sort of things. But he also had some decision making problems, and he made a couple of mistakes in a number of team fights that cost us quite a bit. And it comes down to it is basically that when pub play, you don't necessarily have to make those kind of. There's not as much decision making skills. It's a very basic. I read you. I read how much damage you can do. I go on you because I think that I have 4 and you have 3 and I have 1 more than you and I'm going to win this. It's basically how a lot of pub play works, but there's a lot more teamwork and coordination that goes down. Middle lane, Fluff and Stuff is going to be in some trouble. The plasma field goes out and Fluff and Stuff will be taken down. So right off the bat, as the pause ends, we immediately get some action as Dream Destroyers apparently had a good game plan during that pause timing. They got a support kill and got a tier 1 tower, right? in one fell swoop.
Yeah, and this is what I'm talking about actions in multiple fronts. They're not going to be action on multiple fronts. They're not going to be satisfied with just that mid lane. You've got Pugna turning around, pressuring the tier one top as well. And this is really difficult to deal with here. They are going to get a trade, but this is going to end up being a straight up two towers for one here, I think.
Yeah, and they could even like continue to pressure, if they wanted to, the middle lane and try and do some damage to the tier two. Now, they back themselves up. They don't really have that much vision. They only see two or three heroes in the bottom lane, don't want to overextend themselves. So instead, they're going to play the safer route, rotate up to the top lane, and ensure that tier one tower does in fact go down, that the Pugna's not caught out by any rotations or anything like that. But they do have a wealth of items that are coming in on both sides. The mech is finished off for the Alchemist. We did also have the Pugna at least get his Hood of Defiance, and is going to need a lot more time to be able to farm up. And that's where these tier 2s are going to be so important, and that's why Sneaky Nyx assassins are probably going to fight them tooth and nail for every single one of those.
No, that's exactly the point that I was just getting ready to make. You might see Nature's Prop. Nope, Bloody Nine's going to be fine up here. That's the point. Exactly the point I was going to make, that tower gold is really what Pugna needs. You see TC decrept up in the mid lane. He's going to be fine. Oh, way too is a great deal of trouble, though.
Sprouted up. We also have the Brewmaster Ultimate as well as the Spin. They're going to go for Chovo. We have him trying to drain away on the Fire Pen. It's keeping him alive for a very long time. Finally, Omni Slash goes in, but he soaked up so much damage. Bloody Nine also going to be taken out. Silence comes out from Fluff and stuff on the Chikiro, and we also have the Razor thrown up in the air at the same time. Great Ice Path, and Ike's Mike is lacking a target to hit. He's going to get a double one there on Freedom as well as Justin, and should be able to save everybody's life thanks to that double stun as another pause comes out.
I was wondering about that.
And teams are going to be a little bit anxious about these pauses.
Yeah, no, it actually looked to me like there was a little bit of lag in that fight. I'm not entirely surprised. Uh-oh. Well, you always hate to have this happen, but you know, you do need to enforce the rules.
Okay. Bloody Nine.
All right. There you go.
Nice guy. He's gonna go ahead and there. So in the rules, there was only 10 minutes of pause time given per team. Bloody Nine apparently going to. I mean, of course, if teams agree, teams agree. So.
Yeah, he's not saying. Okay, that's awesome. They are going to give Sneaky Nyx assassins a couple minutes of their pause time, and that's very, very nice. Everybody involved wants to play a 5-on-5 balanced match. You know, you don't want to have to have issues like this. What's going on here?
Wait, two. Pausing. Jesus. All right. Apparently, we're good now, or we're not good, and they're just going to control Ike's Mike.
Okay. Oh, well.
Wait, two's like, we don't need any of your pause time. I'll just control two arrows at once. Or Fluff and Stuff will, rather, it looks like. yeah. Anyway, Four Staff's soon going to be up on Bloody Nine as he's going to have himself a good time, I think. Now, once he has that mobility item, his life becomes so much easier against this SNA team.
So why do you think the Four Staff instead of the Blink Dagger, which is something that we've been seeing Nature's Prophets building a lot lately?
Because I think the initiation from SNA is greater, right? The Dream Destroyers, until they have the Blink Dagger up on the Wraith King, don't really have a whole lot of initiation. So they're going to be constantly initiated on the the path of the team fight is going to be determined primarily by this Brewmaster. And I think that having a Blink is a little bit too risky because, obviously, being able to have that Blink and near instant clap damage is going to be putting some serious hurting on you.
Yeah, to me, I think the big answer to me is the Pugna, right? Because the potential value of multiple Four Staffs on this DD lineup for exactly the reasons that you were saying is really, really high. I mean, you want to be able to save that Pugna if he gets out of position. You want to be able to save that Chikiro potentially if he gets out of position with that Four Staff.
DD, well, they had a little bit of stack here. Justin is actually going to pop his Eye of the Storm for it, as apparently they're fully committed to taking time to farm up. Justin does have an Ogre Club, and we're about to see whether or not he's going to grab the point booster along with it or go for the BKB. I do kind of side with you if they're going to just sit back and farm up the pipe, that he should be going for an Aghanim's.
But and Pugna only 450 away from the pipe, so I do feel like Aghanim's is the right choice. But, I mean, that's the thing. Against the lineup that Sneaky Nyx Assassins had, BKB is not bad. I mean, this is a there is some player preference involved here is what I'm trying to say. People tend to talk about item builds in way too absolute terms, in my opinion.
Iggs, Mike, farming up an ancient stack and is going to have another 1,400 gold, and we'll see whether or not he is... What his next item is going to be here. And I say Ix Mike, of course, very loosely, as he's still DC. Apparently, Ix Mike is going to be handed off to Way Too Sexy now. Kind of wish you there was a little indicator to know who is controlling it.
Yeah, just who's controlling who?
Yeah, because if somebody's doing really well, and I have a feeling it's Way Too Sexy because he's known as a very good micro player, I just want to be able to give that person credit if he pulls out some really good plays. Squee in some serious trouble, though. Fluff and Stuff is going to be laying on the hurt. Ice Path is up soon. And he missed the Ice Path, but the mech.
Clutch
mech.
Freedom. And they know this is going on.
Oh, God. This is a disaster here. Way Too Sexy in some serious trouble. Ix Mike will start landing up the Unstable Concoction. Gets two with that one. At the same time, the Ice Path goes off. Chobo will be able to walk himself away. The good force dev. Squee might have just gotten a ticket home there as Bloody Nine saves his ally. Justin, meanwhile, will get a little bit of Static Link, finishes off the Shatter Shaman. Now we'll move on to Degenerate. They already claimed the Wraith King's life. Unstable Concoction now going off. Chobo has come back into play, though, and is going to be able to get that pipe off on Bloody Nine. Too much physical damage. It's going to be able to finish him off, and now Chobo in some serious trouble as well. He starts life draining Ix Mike. Ix Mike getting low, but the regen keeps him up just in time. Bloody Nine with the buyback might just turn into a dieback now, as Sneaky Nyx Assassins are just overwhelming Dream Destroyers. There goes the Razor. Now Bloody Nine is kind of trapped as the Ix Mike has now reconnected at a very poor time.
Oh, no!
Oh, dear.
Oh, that's that's just a devastating fight by DD, and you could see just how knife-edge that timing was. Pugna actually ended up getting the pipe done in the middle of the fight. If he had had that pipe done at the beginning of the fight, that's potentially completely different, but now Sneaky Nyx Assassin's Force, multiple buybacks, get all those kills, they have the Aegis on their Juggernaut, and that all that push momentum that DD had worked so hard to build up is now gone.
Yeah, look at that giant climb up and a giant drop back down. And experience doing something similar, though, jumping even further in the favor of SNA, where before the gold was actually in favor of Dream Destroyers. Now we're going to see Way Too Sexy. He's going to be caught. Hex goes out. Ice Path will hold him in for a bit longer. And with the Dual Breath, they should be able to finish him off. That damage over time will do its work. He'll get off a last little shackle. Bloody Nine will actually possibly die because of that. Ix Mike is going to start going on him on the left side. Skywrath Mage gets taken down by the two supports. Now Ix Mike is going to get turned around on as the Sprout holding him in place, but he will just teleport himself away. Now we actually at the left side, Juggernaut continues to try and go on the supports, comes in, does get off a good spin in order to dodge the Wraith King stun. And now it's going to be sprouted up. TC comes in with a big clap, but there goes the pipe. Dealing all that damage, nothing is actually done to anybody, pretty much. Freedom is going to be gone on, but he still has a reincarnation. He doesn't care about this. They could actually possibly kill the Broolings this early on. Just the Earth Panda is left already. Ix Mike, and they're finally going to finish off Freedom, but the slow goes out. He does get the stun onto Squee. The spin also going down. Looks like TC is going to try and finish off that dragon, and the Omni Slash starts bouncing around. Pugna getting very, very low. Gets off the mech at the last second, and a good blast deals a good amount of damage, but they're still now on their way out. These tanks are just too much for them to handle. Beautiful body blocking there. And the right side, we do have Justin who finishes off two with the help of Freedom. The ward's not quite enough. Ix Mike still having trouble getting around those trees. Justin going to be taken out by the clap, and now Freedom teleports himself away just in time. And the same goes for the Pugna. So a bit of a better fight this time around for Dream Destroyers, but the tanks of SNA, they are just so damn hard to kill right now for Dream Destroyers.
That would have been these little guys right here at the Haste Rune. I think one DD that fight, because if those Treants had not been there, not just the block, but the fact that Juggernaut couldn't use his Omni Slash. He had like 8 Treants walking around him. What's that going to do?
Yeah, just terrible timing. He just like couldn't really find any openings to get a good Omni Slash. And finally, when he did, it wasn't quite enough to finish off the Pugna.
Right. Now, and Pugna, this is going to make a big difference because Pugna did just finish off an Ogre Club going toward his Ag Scepter, presumably. And that's even that's just going to make a huge difference in terms. I mean, it's you know almost going to be like a 30% increase in his HP.
Yeah. Every point of HP gives you so much more on the Pugna now that you have that pipe finished up and you have that high amount of magic defense. The problem for me, I see. Well, the Aghanims will definitely increase your damage by quite a bit on the Pugna because obviously there are some stuns that are going to air up to you, so you need that constant life drain. But it's more the fact that the regen on this Alchemist is just overwhelming every bit of damage that they do.
Ew. Jug did go Battle Fury. Well, I guess they're going to have a lead here. They're going to have some things to work with, but I don't know. I don't like this choice. I guess the thinking is that you know, if as in that last fight, you don't have much AoE necessarily to clear out those treants and to clear out any other summonable units. Presumably Pugna will eventually pick up that Necro Book, even if he's not going for it quite as early on here, and Nature's Prophet as well. You know, I guess it makes sense to build more right click in this game, but still that Aghanim's build on Jug is just so good in my view.
The one thing I do like about the Battle Fury build here is that Dream Destroyers have no way to stop him from teleporting away. Right, so he can really aggressively split push and just Blade Fury teleport out every single time. In fact, he should really never be caught because, again, there's no initiation on the side of Dream Destroyers. Even once they have the blink, that's a missile stun. So you should be able to get off your spin before he finishes the animation and the stun lands.
Yeah, no, that's true, and that's a very good point. That's something you don't necessarily think about Juggernaut as the classic split pusher, but in this meta...
Middle lane, they're going to go for Chobo. Chobo already taken out by the wards. The Brewmaster will now move on to the next target, which is going to be Squeed, throwing the Razor up in the air. Freedom also teleporting in to try and help out his ally. He's going to focus on the Fire Panda that is doing so much damage right now. He even forced to stun it as the secondary clap comes out from the Zone 1. Now TC gets held in by the Ice Path. Not quite so sure they're going to have the opportunity to really keep him in place. The Omni Slash bouncing around, but with a Creep Wave coming in and run, that's also going to do nothing. Freedom getting low. He doesn't have a reincarnation, so he's trying to back himself up. The rest of Dream Destroyers trying to kite around the members of Sneaky Nyx Assassins while also not wanting to extend themselves into the wards actually results in a really good fight for them. A Brewmaster ultimate used for a Pugna by itself is not that bad. But then the Brewmaster dying as he comes back from that Brewmaster form actually makes the fight quite good for DD.
Yeah, but this is starting to worry me, even though that they've done fine in the last two fights. You see how problematic it is when you have a Pugna and you're not the ones pushing. When you have a Pugna and you're the ones being initiated on, it's just so, so tough. And that's why Pugna is such a high-risk, high-reward pick in this metagame, that squishy cores are just such a risk. And here, Chobo. Even you might see him go down just a way too.
Yeah, he's going to die here as the Ike's Mike should be able to ensure it. As Blast goes off, he couldn't get the Decrepify of Offman himself, but Way Too Sexy has already been taken down. And in fact, thanks to the mech as well from the Furan, he's going to be able to turn this around. Now, unfortunately, once again, they do not have any stuns to be able to stop Ike's Mike as he teleports right underneath their nose for the second time in the last 5 minutes. But at least they saved the Pugna, and they come in. So this global mech, man, it's an interesting idea that's doing a decent amount of work for them.
Yeah, and that's at least the second just absolutely clutch mech that Bloody Nine has had in these last few exchanges to save a teammate's life. But even there, you saw if Way Too Sexy had Mass Serpent Wards up when he went for that. I mean, he had the DD, so he decided why not. But if he had his ulti up for that, that's a kill. Mm-hmm.
So I kind of figured that Aghanim's would still be a viable build after you finish up the Battle Fury, because by the time you have Ags, you'll have your level 3 ultimates, so your Omni Slash is actually really effective, and you've got this cleave damage. Apparently, we're going to be seeing a Battle Fury or a BKB instead.
No, I'm with him here. That to me, I mean, once you commit to the Battle Fury build, Aghanim's still... You know, sure, Battle Fury is primarily a farming and split pushing item, but to me, once you commit to the Battle Fury build, a lot of the times you're going to want to go ahead and just go right click.
Well, we'll see how it works for them. I'm not convinced he really has enough mobility just yet to really make use of his right click damage.
Well, hence the BKB. But the thing is, right, the Brewmaster is farming so well, he's going to have his AC up fairly soon, and that makes that right click build by the Juggernaut. I actually would have. You know, if you really wanted to get crazy, you go Deso now on the Juggernaut. And to me, that's gonna just be a huge spike in their physical damage output. And I'm not sure that that DD have the tankiness to survive that kind of output.
Well, we'll see. 17-16 right now. The kill score looking pretty even. In fact, even in the favor of Dream Destroyers. But the gold graph will give us a little bit more information about that. 500 lead for DD and a 2,500 experience lead for SNA. But I really feel like it's still SNA's game. They're holding a bit more. They're also controlling the map a lot more than Dream Destroyers. Because, again, the Juggernaut is always able to aggressively push out one lane. And then you have this Shadow Shaman hero who is basically able to solo kill anybody he comes across. That's the real power of Serpent Wards right now, is that they are not only this excellent pushing ability, but once your Shadow Shaman has a blink, he can go into these side lanes and just wait for someone to try and push, and he can easily pick them off as long as he's able to get that ward block and they don't have like a ton of health or even phase boots.
Yeah, especially if that somebody is the Pugna. I mean, that's exactly why that kind of squishy core can be so devastating, that it, in this environment, if you have, okay, maybe an engagement coming up down here, but if you have a support that can 1v1 one of your cores, that's a big problem.
See, Fluff and Stuff still fearlessly farming in the enemy jungle as they've spread themselves out very thin right now. Looks like they're going to be depending on the Furion once again as Chobo's going to be initiated on. This time they do have the added nukes of Fluff and Stuff. He doesn't have enough mana for his ultimate just yet. Once again, the mech will go off for Chobo. He's going to be able to turn this around. He does have enough to be able to live through that. Fluff and Stuff also going to fall as Freedom comes around the back. And they get both of those support kills. TC's now going to come in, as well as the blink from IX Mike. They blow up the Pugna real quickly and now move on to try and catch somebody else. Bloody Nine has already gotten himself some distance, as well as the Wraith King is going to teleport out before IX Mike could get another unstable concoction. But still, a 1-for-2. It was still a core for 2 supports, so not bad one way or another. The important thing for me is that Dream Destroyers still hold on to the Primal Split.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's not a bad trade, but again, they have so much riding on this Pugna's item progression, and you see he's buying, he's actually going for BKB here over the Aghanims, and I think that's right. I think you have to at this point. You got to do something about just getting locked down and insta-gibbed in these fights. But yeah, this is an example of where the golden XP graphs really don't tell the whole story. The whole construction of DD's lineup is based around the fact that they're going to push and they're going to have this huge tower advantage, and they do have a one tower advantage, but it's just not enough at this point. And Juggernaut, okay, he's not your traditional late game carry, but in this game, he's going to get there. He has the potential, and he's going to get to the point where DD's just not going to be able to deal with him.
Right, it seems like Dream Destroyers are now trying to orient themselves towards a little bit more late game themselves, as it seems clear they're not going to be able to end this game within the next 10 minutes.
Okay.
So they're trying to build into some late game items. Especially with Koipa and the way he ran his Pugna up against the Tinker. Now, that was a very special matchup because he was basically the Tinker is the one position and the Pugna is the one position, and they're back and forth. And so that was a special case. But it still gave me a little bit more respect for Pugna going into late game when he does have that Aghanims, especially because the buff to the range of Life Drain actually makes it so much more viable, as it is so hard, similar to Static Link, to actually break that link once and for all.
Well, my friend, I've been, as Knicks do take a free Roshan here, I've been burned one too many times and have learned the hard way that, you know, you don't draw conclusions from like one or two matches with the best farming players in the world. That doesn't necessarily indicate that the hero is viable, although I do agree with the basics of what you said, that was an incredible match by Koikpa. I'm just, you know, much like the Luo carry Invoker, right? That it sure looked like carry Invoker was viable watching Luo play him at TI4, but you ask yourself, how many players in the world can pull that off? I'm just not sure.
True. I'm just saying that the hero has a little bit more late game viability than what I would originally call it, which was, okay, if it's past 35 minutes, you're on a Pugna, you better have a damn hard-ass carry, otherwise he's not going to do anything for you. I think Pugna's a little bit more viable than I gave him credit for. And the other thing is that it's not going to be just on him, right? We have a Razor who's going to be able to finish up an Aghanims very soon. He's going to go for the Refresher route. Then we also have a Furion, who is obviously a very strong late-game hero as well in his own right. So I do think they do have some late game viability. I still think SNA have better late game, but they definitely can plan for that and try and do as what they can. Ice Path on two in the middle lane. They also have Lenny Nine, who's going to be able to come in, but a beautiful initiation, their counter initiation from TC's. Gets off his ultimate, already finishing off the Furion, and the rest of Dream Destroyers will back themselves up away from that one. Now Squee is going to be left to die here, as the Omni Slash is going to be used on him. Three members back themselves out on the side of Dream Destroyers, one core and one support dying apiece. But it looks like Sneaky Nyx Assassins are going to try and take the Tier 1 off of this one, saying it's way too sexy, still holding on to his Serpent Wards.
Now, I should mention, Brewmaster chose to go for the Shivas as opposed to the AC, which I thought he might go. Of course, that's because Alchemist is going to go for the AC. Could be a Mjolnir, but I doubt it.
Chobo gets a little too close, and he's going to be taken down before he can possibly decrepify himself or anything else. Unfortunately, that's just him trying to play a very aggressive war, despite the fact that, really, that was a guaranteed tower. They still have the Aegis on the Juggernaut as well, so there were little issues with SNA being able to claim that tower.
And this is where I think what you said earlier about the Juggernaut starts to come into play, that they don't have anything that can stop him from TPing out. He basically, he can farm the whole map right now. And that's why it's such a big deal that DD are at parity instead of at an advantage in terms of map control. This Juggernaut can go wherever he wants. I mean, he doesn't have a blink like Animage does, but he has access to the entire map. And now you're starting to see Alchemist doing the Ancients here, making that transition into a core role himself. I just feel like the late game potential, given the way that the actual heroes are farming in this match, goes so strongly in favor of Nyx.
We have Ix Mike, who's going to be finishing off at Assault Cuirass himself, leaving the Brewmaster with that Shiva, as he mentioned earlier. So they're going to have both the big armor items here pretty soon, which just means that this Razor is going to be left with very limited effectiveness, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Way too sexy. He's going to find Bloody Nine, holds him with the Hex for the time being. Unstable Concoction, going to follow it up. Bloody Nine does get the chance to Force Staff there, and that's just because Way Too Sexy didn't actually get off the Shackles. He's actually going to get out here. TC stunned up immediately, does have an ultimate, gets off the clap. They just don't have the stunts to make sure that he doesn't get off that ultimate. He immediately starts focusing on the Pugnum Ward. Ix Mike doing something similar here, but he's going to get blown up in the process. Freedom going for Way Too Sexy, not quite enough. He gets turned into a sheep and now Ward trapped up. He does have the reincarnation, so he's going to be fine. Justin, meanwhile, trying to finish off these Panda. He could actually get it. Last Panda almost left alive. Just one more hit and he would have finished it off. Back up to Freedom, where he's taking the full amount of the Omni Slash right now. Beautiful Decrepify, though, from Chobo. Not going to be quite enough to save him. Degenerate still has that Aegis, though. If he's left alone against so many heroes, they're going to be in some serious trouble as he gets put into that decrepified state. Taken down, and now they're just going to surround him and quickly kill him a second time as he has no real way out of this one. As Decrepify slows him down a little bit, Justin getting close enough for enough right clicks, and DD walk away from that one with a really good position. A Sneaky Nyx Assassins, it's so simple how that could have been just a very simple pickoff on the Furion. But the failure to shackle there from Way Too Sexy, because he expected the Unstable Concoction, turned into them massively overextending themselves and getting to a terrible team fight.
Yeah, but I can't put that on one player, okay? That's a mistake for sure, but they chose to commit to that fight when the Juggernaut was out of position. There's just no reason right now that you fight without that Juggernaut, who has a Battle Fury, Sanjin, Yasha, BKB. I mean, that's your farm, that's your damage output. It's a huge error to force that fight, and yeah, I mean, you can always say that one player could have hit a spell better, but you got to disengage from that, in my opinion.
Dream Destroyers will now back themselves up. We have, instead of a refresher for the Razor, he actually picks himself up a plate now and is looking to be going an Assault Cuirass.
Yeah, that's kind of how AC works. You see in a lot of these games, it's kind of a mutually assured destruction thing that you get one and I have to get one, just because, especially in this situation with the Pugna, the Furion, and the Jakiro, and even the Wraith King, who, if you compare, is pretty far behind in farm compared to the Alchemist. They're just going to be so squishy, that physical damage, if you let that AC go uncontested. He could go Shivas as well, by the way. That's another that also mitigates physical damage, and it's kind of a little bit of six of one, half a dozen of the other. I've seen Razors going Shivas slightly more often at this point.
I much prefer the Assault Cuirass for the laser because of the minus armor, but we'll see where he chooses to go with one. It's certainly the more expensive item, and if he does go for the Assault Cuirass, I would say he probably needs to be able to get himself like an immediate vitality booster, because he's going to need some extra HP at this point just to be able to utilize that high amount of armor that he's got. Bottom lane is going to be pushed in by Way Too Sexy. Teleport.
Oh.
Almost got it there. The Furion was very close to be able to catch him out. But still, he doesn't have that Scythe of Ice yet. I just noticed. Bloody Nine is going to be building in it soon. He's really not that far away from it, but he needs a bit more time. And then they have another solid disable, which is so important. They're really lacking in them right now because their supports are just like the Wraith King, single target stun is okay, but not amazing. And then they have the Ice Path, which is a pretty meh disable at this point in time. Can be amazing in team fights, but when it comes to locking down one hero and bursting it, it's pretty terrible.
I'm a little bit surprised that Bloody Nine here chose to finish off the Mjolnir before the Scythe device, just because, as we've been saying, that lack of a hard disable to stop TPs and in the team fights. I mean, imagine if they had Brewmaster really cornered in that last engagement bought by the T2, and just there was no way that they were going to be able to burst him down. I mean, imagine if that Scythe device is up, right? That just gives you so many more options in those engagements. I feel like this is also the point, by the way, where you really do possibly end up wishing that Furion had a Blink Dagger instead of that Force Staff, because he at least then becomes a credible single target initiator.
Brewmaster, TC is actually going to be building into an Abyssal, interesting enough. As his next item. Do they have a Vlad's?
Yeah, I'm surprised.
They do not.
They don't, and that's such a good item.
They got Degenerate. They actually managed to jump in with the Wraith King and be able to hit the stun, and because of that, the follow-up Ice Path and all the magic damage was all able to hit the Juggernaut. They get a beautiful pickup that is going to result in the Tier 2 going down in this top lane. I highly doubt SNA want to throw a buyback just to defend a Tier 2. Instead, they immediately go for a split push. You can see TC runs into the middle lane and is desperate to try and push that out as soon as possible, because they don't want to have DD go uphill completely uncontested, but
yeah,
they will be forced to.
They can't trade this. They have to TP back, because they can threaten the DD can threaten the T3 here easily. And this is a solid last few minutes of this game coming out from DD.
Ike's Mike does get stunned up. Ice Path follow up. And Way Too Sexy is going to be making his way back. The pipe has already been used to make sure some of the creeps stay healthy, and they do already take down this Tier 3. Melee Rax is going down. Now the buyback as TC hits the initiation with the Shivas. Now the Ice Path is going to be able to lock down a couple. Bloody Nine is going to be the target of the Omni Slapster. Actually, is going to be able to get himself out. Possibly he does. He managed to Force Staff himself away as the Omni Slash ended up getting on the creeps. And the result is DD just managed to get themselves a Tier 3 forced to buyback and lost nobody in the process.
Yeah, that push from DD, I really questioned whether or not they were going to be able to sustain any kind of momentum here, because generally this is around the time in the game where you often see these push lineups stalling out if they're at map control parity. But they've played the last few fights very, very well. Some misplays, as we've said, coming out from Sneaky Nyx Assassins, and they've really taken advantage. And I mean, this is just what I say about Dota all the time. It's a game of mistakes, and it's not whether you make them, because everybody's going to make them. But it's whether or not you're able to exploit your opponents and whether or not you're able to recover from your own. And DD over the last 5 or 6 minutes of this match has just done a much, much better job of that.
The full Scythe of Ice going to be finished up. Chobo is also going to be able to get an Aghanim's, which is a huge upgrade for him. The Jakiro actually has a Ghost Scepter, which is obviously makes a big difference against the Juggernaut as well. And we have a Wraith King who's going to be building into a full Assault Cuirass himself, while the Shivas was picked up by Justin. So again, the double armor items. I would still side with the Assault Cuirass for the Razor, but if Wraith King is getting this amount of farm, sure. Let's see an Assault Cuirass on a Wraith King instead, 100%.
Oh. Yeah, and this is where DD in the last few minutes, they're just making plays all over the map here, man.
Freedom. Smoke has already been popped, and they realize this, SNA. They had the vision of that smoke popping. They may not know the rest of the heroes are here, but obviously there's nobody smoking off by themselves. 2200 gold up on Bloody Nine. He can actually start affording his next big ticket item as the Ring of Bacillus can easily be sold. What do you think he's going to be building in from here, though?
Ah, boy. That's tough. I think you got to go BKB at some point if you're going to go carry Fury in like this. I mean, I think you've got to... You know, at some point, they're going to be able to focus you.
The push in through the middle lane is going to transition into a push into the top lane. SNA do kind of realize this, but at the same time, there's not too much they can do about it. They have to push back the middle lane at the top lane exposed since that tier 3 is down. TC looking for that initiation, just does a gentle Shiva's trying to push them back as the unstable concoction going to be able to hit Freedom as well. Freedom does have the reincarnation, so he's not too scared of going down just yet. A little bit of poke action with the Eye of the Storm, but the Eye of the Storm is going to be fading soon, and this is why SNA are going to start pushing themselves out. Unstable Concoction, going to go for Chobo, doesn't really have that target, finally gets it off in Bloody Nine instead. Macropyre goes out, Chobo, Omni Slash is going to take him down right quick. Squee also going to be silenced up, and it looks like Fluff and Stuff may try and drop the bomb, doesn't have enough mana for it. Omni Slash pursuing him, Bloody Nine is going to be taken out by IX Mike, and they're going to go for Freedom as well, who still has that reincarnation. Finally, the Chikiro taken out by Degenerate. Freedom did manage to get himself a blink just before the unstable concoction goes out, and that means two heroes will end up surviving against that push out from SNA. Very well timed by them too, and knowing that the Eye of the Storm was going down in the next couple of seconds, their best hope of being able to take a fight was during that time.
Yeah, that was kind of the counter initiation that I had been expecting out of Sneaky Nyx Assassins for really the last 10 minutes of this match. I mean, you look at it against the push lineup, you've gotten your core items up, you've gotten an alchemist that's definitely transitioned into a core role. That's the kind of counter initiation when they push up high ground that you expect coming out of Sneaky Nyx Assassins' team in this situation. I don't know what's going on here.
Mike, Kevin, some more issues, but we do have some big couple of items being picked up on the side of SNA. We do have the cheese, is going to go the way of the Brewmaster, and they also have the Abyssal Blade. And meanwhile, we also have the Aegis that's picked up by the Juggernaut, who's going to be building into a Battle Fury. It looks like instead of trying to use any more pause time, once again, Mike is going to try and fix himself while his allies go ahead and control his hero. What other?
Yeah, that's going to be a butterfly on the Juggernaut. You said Battle Fury, but that's okay.
I've butterfly. Yeah.
It looks like the Wraith King here is still trying to complete that Assault Cuirass, and the butterfly already complete on the Juggernaut. I like the gentle Shivas, by the way, in that last.
It wasn't like a hard Shivas where you pop the Shivas and just dive in, you know,
just
and
give
pop
it to
the
him
ultimate.
Gently.
Yeah, you just kind of push him back a little bit, just, you know, poke at him. Just like, hey, now calm down, buddy. There's no need to go for those Raxes just yet. And it worked, right? DD were like, the gentle Shivas calmed them down. They're like, maybe we shouldn't go for this Rax. And they kind of settling down. Okay, we'll back ourselves up. We'll go for another siege later. And bam, that's when SNA go for the initiation.
No, that's right. And again, I mean, anytime DD's lineup gets initiated on, they're very, very, very vulnerable. I mean, when they're the ones forcing the action, it's just a completely different story. Okay, Mike is able to get back in, so hopefully those will stabilize, because we're going to have at least one more game in this series after this. This is only game one here, folks.
Yeah.
To me, a lot of the story right now is that Wraith King is just, in terms of farm, he is behind this Alchemist, and as you would expect, that's mostly Grievous Greed there. One side having an AC and not the other is a pretty big advantage in these fights, really.
Looks like Bloody Nine's going to be going for the BKB, and then I guess inevitably selling the mech in favor of a damage dealing item such as a Daedalus, which...
Boy, I don't know. You hope it doesn't get that far, because I think if the game gets that far that he's doing that they're in a great deal of trouble.
Yeah, and you've lost so much by being able to sell that mech. I mean, even going into late game, it still makes a big difference due to, I mean, the small amount of increase is nice even going into late game, but the armor aura and everything else can make a pretty significant difference when it's put on five heroes. So it's not something you really want to be doing, but it may just be something you kind of have to do. And they're going to back themselves up, at least for the time being. They may try and control. They've got both the middle and bottom lanes pushing out. Obviously, they need to go top lane where that tier 3, they can still take advantage of the fact that that's down?
Yeah, it is going to start to be an issue. I mean, when you look at the creep equilibrium, Sneaky Nyx Assassins is having to do quite a lot just to keep those lanes pushed out, right? Because there's just so much more spammable AoE on that. Well, not necessarily spammable AoE, but there's just so much more push in general over on that DD side.
Boots of Travel now being picked up by the Juggernaut, as he has pretty much got himself six slotted. He got obviously replaced the Aegis with another item eventually, but for the time being, what does the last item on a Juggernaut look like? Like, what exactly do you go for? Aghanims is still a big upgrade, but most of the time, you're going to go for a big damage dealing item.
Yeah, it's past the time that you go for Aghanims. You've already got that built-in crit, so you're probably going to go something like MKB. Yeah, even though you don't necessarily, I mean, hurts you a little bit to do that with, though that's actually, you know what, I just answered that question. I was thinking I might have messed up. No, Furion's damage dealing item should, of course, be MKB.
Because of
the brew and the butterfly.
Yeah, we have way too much evasion on their side.
Yeah.
Aix Mike is currently sitting on a BKB as well as an Assault Cuirass. We have TC with that Abyssal that he picked up a while ago and still hasn't picked up a next item. Fluff and Stuff has managed to finally arrange himself an item of his own, which is the Rod of Atos, and it's probably going to be going into the Yule Scepter, I would imagine, as his next item. Shadow Shaman does have a Aegis, or Aghanims, and it's the items with the same letter in the name. Bottom lane, Aix Mike in some trouble, is going to be able to get off the BKB, and will be able to start regening up significantly, and that's where that regen buff really comes into play now, as he's just going to keep on wailing on heroes as soon as he gets to him. Freedom is trying to get in enough distance for Blink, and will be able to get in just a second, gets away. And is going to be able to teleport out before Aix Mike can get him. So it's just going to be a Furion pickoff. Unfortunately, though, SNA probably not going to really be able to capitalize on this one. They can probably get the tier 2, but they probably won't be able to push uphill, as Razor has already got the mid push going. And somebody's going to have to go back to defend that.
No, I mean, this is the kind of thing, it's not necessarily the most exciting thing to talk about, but at this point in the match, the creep equilibrium really does become a big deal. The fact that this mid lane is pushed all the way to their base really limits what they can do with a pickoff like that. And Furion has buyback anyway.
And these tier 2s being taken out are important because it now evens up. The next time they have an opening like that, they can probably push uphill. Now, it looks like they're still going to try and force the buyback just like Dream Destroyers did, similar to them. And because there's no longer a Razor in the mid lane, there's no possibility of a split push really affecting them.
They don't have the material to force the buyback, and they're going to back off like this shit here. They're going to try and get these lane. I mean, what they need to do right now is get the map overall in a position where if that happens again, they can try and take some material inside DD's base, because it's just such a huge advantage. I mean, it's just like having a 2-1 chip lead in poker, right? Where if DD win a fight at this point, that Sneaky Nyx Assassin's base is in a good deal of trouble. Sneaky Nyx Assassins need to put themselves in that same position.
Yeah, Fury not really doing much split pushing. Looks like they really want to force a fight here in this mid lane. They're going to go for it already. Freedom on the front line. Meanwhile, TC getting in a really good initiation and starts targeting Bloody Nine. Gets a couple of bashes before popping his ultimate. Now turns for Chobo. He's going to have to be forced to pop his BKB. Get away from Aix Mike. Justin copying a full brunt of that Omni Slash. Turns around, unable to finish off Degenerate just yet, as that Butterfly does some serious work. Finally, he does go down. Freedom, meanwhile, already losing one reincarnation and the Ice Path as well. Aix Mike just explodes on himself. Suicide! So late into this game, and an outing suicide via the unstable concoction, which he just could not release. Fluff and Stuff at the last second of his teleport away. Justin is able to finish him off, and now Dream Destroyers. Good decision by them to be able to force that mid fight with a full force. I really thought they should have been going for more split push with the Furion, but they took the fight head on and are now going to be rambling into the mid lane, where they're going to force a lot of buybacks from SNA. Otherwise, they can just simply transition from mid to top and get a 2-racks advantage. All three of Nyx Assassins do have a buyback, though.
What? Okay, I just had a brain cramp here. What happened to Jug's Aegis?
He lost it. He lost it before when they were going in for that bottom push.
Okay, all right. Yeah. For whatever reason, because of the item discussions, I thought he might have still had an Aegis there. And okay, good. That I Wow, I'm a little bit surprised that they committed to that fight as heavily as they did in that case. I mean, that was, you know, that was the opposite of the gentle Shivas. That was the very rough Shivas by TC as he blinked into the middle of four DD heroes to start off that fight. But just ended up being way, way over aggressive. And interestingly enough, Juggernaut has chosen to go lifesteal here.
Okay, I mean, he did have some serious HP problems in the last fight, as we saw, despite the fact that he was a, like, he's got all this evasion, he's able to output a lot of damage, he still has a lot of magic damage he has to be afraid of when he's not spinning and everything else, so, I mean, lifesteal is always kind of necessary on carries going into the late game most of the time.
Okay, so okay, Yeah, this is why I was a little bit surprised, because you really, especially as the dire side in this situation for Sneaky Nyx Assassins, before you do what you did in that last fight, and again, there is some value to getting that tier 2 down for the reasons that we've discussed, but you really want to have Aegis on the Jug in this situation.
Right. I can't believe nobody has a Vlad's, though. They're running three melee cores.
And it's not even the melee cores. It's the flat damage bonus.
Oh, yeah.
At this point, for both the Alchemist and the Juggernaut is significant.
I mean, if you have a Vlad's, there's your lifesteal for the right. Juggernaut. It doesn't need the Juggernaut, needs to hold it.
Right.
Like, the Brewmaster is one of the most ideal targets because he keeps the aura up, even now through his ultimate.
I think it's way, way underrated in this situation. As crazy as it sounds, I would actually rather see a Vlad's on the Skywrath than the Rod of Atos. Or the Brewmaster, for instance. I think that, yeah, you can't argue with the Abyssal Blade. That's a good item in terms of the lockdown potential there. But he could afford a Vlad's right now if he wanted one.
Yeah. And same goes with the Alchemist. I mean, he could have been able to afford a Vlad's by now, but.
Yep.
Apparently it's just an item that, well, it does sneak some people's minds, you know? Like, everybody in general agrees, like, okay, every team should have a Vlad's on your team when you start going past, like, 45 minutes. If you have the extra gold and you have the inventory slots, somebody should probably have a Vlad's. But, you know, you see some of the top teams still not having it just because, well, they prioritize other items. Maybe they forget about the Vlad's. Somebody goes, do we have a Vlad's? And everybody's like, no, not me. I went for my Rod of Atos. That's one of you guys.
And yeah, then the cores are like, that's kind of the thing, that individually, it's hard to criticize any of their heroes' builds. I mean, they all have very, very good and standard items, but, you know, other than maybe the Abyssal and the Brewmaster, of course. But yeah, you sure would like to have that Vlad's and not have to have the Juggernaut burn a slot on lifesteal, which he's got the Aegis now anyway. I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, interesting enough, that could still at this point be a Vlad's, that Morbid Mask.
Yeah, I think it's maybe a bit more likely.
Odd, but could be.
Yeah. Teleport in, and I don't think SNA are really looking for. I think they're probably going to spend a few more minutes looking for an opening somewhere, or at least trying to split push or something along those guards. Because they have a lot of time on this Aegis. There's no reason to try and rush in into 5-manning just yet. If they can maybe wait and just look for a pickoff, if they don't get one in like 2 minutes' time, okay, then let's go ahead and 5-man in.
TC. It's a good point because we're going here.
Yeah, they can't really go on him. He already pops a BKB, and now Chobo's going to be locked down. That's the important part. Good for staff, though. Gets him away, and this has actually left a lot of exposure. There is the tier 3 tower down. At the same time, we have a BKB down on the Brewmaster as well as the Alchemist Ultimate, which is going to be fading here. It's already halfway through its duration. If they can try and push out, similar to what SNA did a while back in that top Terry. Still, though, Degenerate really gunning for these Raxes. He's going to be trapped inside the Sprout, though. Being targeted, he does have the Aegis as well as the Omni Slash. Let's lose the Omni Slash now. And starts bouncing around. The rest of the team is going to be angling for that Tier 3. But not able to get it just yet. The Aegis fades, and Juggernaut's going to be coming back right into the ice path, taking a huge amount of damage. The rest of his team is still dealing with a Wraith King of all heroes, who has managed to just basically fight 1v3 and save their tier 3 from going down. Finally, the Brewmaster will be forced to pop his ultimate. Freedom getting low, but he still has his reincarnation to fall back on. And the Brewmaster should be able to get out up top. Bloody Nine going for Way Too Sexy. Way Too Sexy, who already blown his wards, is going to be defended here by IX Mike, who stuns himself at the last second. Bloody Nine not going for that kill. Back to the Panda Brewmaster, where his ultimate is running out. At this last second, Ice Path does grab him, though. And TC will finally fall. Once again, Dream Destroyers managing to defend their base, but at a cost of a couple of buildings.
Yeah, but I don't like to flame anybody, but the only way I can explain that fight is just a massive failure of communication. Way 2 had actually dropped his wards on the top lane, and those wards just, the rest of the team was mid going on the Wraith King who blinked out, and those wards just got farmed up immediately, and the Juggernaut was kind of like, hey guys, I thought we were going top, and just got caught completely out of position, burning the Aegis. Chobo might be going down here though. This is huge for Sneaky Nyx Assassins.
BKB activated, and Chobo trying to get himself some distance. He does have the boots of travel and actually be able to get himself away. Meanwhile, the rest of the members going up to the top lane. Melee Rax is going to be falling soon, but the glyph is activated. Here comes the mass teleports. IX Mike only has his chemical rage for a little bit longer. Wraith King, though, using his armlet when he can to try and keep himself alive, but finally reincarnation goes down. IX Mike pops his BKB as the chemical rage fades. Degenerate also keeping them alive with that healing ward. Finally, the Melee Rax will go down. Way 2 seconds. It gets off a decent little ward trap, but already the wards are being cleaned up by the rest of the team. IX Mike gets off. Two-man unstable concoction, but he may fall here. Justin finally gets in one more clean, but it's still not enough. He actually heals up just enough. Degenerate, though, will fall under the onslaught, and I think this is possibly GG. Dream Destroyers are going to go from top into the middle lane where they have the tier 3 already so low. Buybacks are up on nobody except for the Alchemist on the side of SNA, but it's going to be too late. The Juggernaut is really the important hero right now, and he doesn't have his buyback. It was both on time and on gold. This is going to be them cleaning up all three sets of racks before SNA are possibly back up, and that has got to be GG. TC is going to come in, trying to put a stop to this one without the Juggernaut. Chobo already four staff away, and a BKB goes off as well. Unstable concoction thrown out by IX Mike. They're going to go on, clean him up real quickly. Justin now moves on to TC and activates the second Eye of the Storm. And that it is. GG. Way 2 Sexy calls it, and Dream Destroyers, after what was an hour-long marathon of a game with so many pauses, is finally goes their way.
Just and awesome. I am so impressed. I was talking with some people in the chat before the game, and a couple of people were saying, look, you know, this DD team, they're okay, but really it was more of a case of them just out-drafting in their games yesterday, that they didn't really even play all that well. I don't think you can say that here. I think that these were two very, very even drafts, and I think DD just surprisingly, given how long some of these Sneaky Nyx Assassins players have played together, DD were the team that in the last 10 or 15 minutes of the game in these big engagements were the ones communicating and executing. So great job by them, and they take the 1-0 advantage here in our best of three series.
And that means, guys, we are going to be taking a short little break as we get ourselves into Game 2, DD versus SNA. Game 2 coming up next.